Hi, and welcome to Word of Faith Family. I'm so glad that you tuned in today. We love it that you're coming to Facebook Church and also to YouTube Church. But remember, there's nothing like being here. I'm telling you, the Spirit of the Lord is here. You need to be here. But we want to encourage you. 10:30 on Sunday mornings, 7 o'clock on Wednesday nights. God's in the house. You need to be in the house too. But if you can't be in the house, Facebook Church and YouTube Church is for you. So tune in, and it's always good. Dale's been studying, praying, and he's got the message from the Lord for you today. And so I know that you're going to really like it. So remember, we're just fixing to go into this service, and I want you to remember that we give not only in the side of the church, but we give on Giveify and on PayPal, and then we have a drop box out in the driveway of the church. And so there's all different ways that you can give and that you can be faithful unto the Lord. Hey, are you ready? Let's just get right in to Pastor Dale. Come on.
All right, you ready? Lord, I choose to obey your word, for as I dwell and walk in your presence, I shall not lack. Poverty be far from me and my household in Jesus' name. I will walk in your blessings, Lord. I will rise above all that hell has to offer and accept heaven's best here on earth. Everything I set my hands to will prosper because I make you my dwelling place. You are my refuge and my fortress. Thank you, Lord, for your provision. I accept it by faith, fully expecting your blessings in every area of my life. For wherever your presence is, there is no lack. Therefore, Lord, as we receive today's offering, we are believing you for abundant harvest, health, jobs and better jobs, raises and bonuses, benefits, sales and commissions, favorable settlements, estates and inheritance, interest and income, rebates and returns, checks in the mail, gifts and surprises, scholarships and grants, inventions with royalties, finding money, bills paid off, bills decreased, blessings and increase, bargains and child support. Thank you, Lord, for meeting all of our financial needs, that we may have more than enough to give into the kingdom of God and promote the gospel of Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. Amen. All right. We got started last week. Now, most of you were here. Not everybody, of course, but last week I entitled the sermon, Fellowship Through Friendship. And I tried to explain what a friend is, and I asked everybody a question last week. Who remembers the question that I asked you? I'm not kidding. Anybody remember besides me? That's because I wrote it down. No. That was week four. Last week's question was, how many friends do you have? And then I proceeded to explain what a real friend is. Amen. And I'm quite sure that the number that we might have had before the sermon started and the number that we ended up with, if we thought about it, was probably quite a bit fewer. We learn in life, and I learned this a long time ago, that we have a lot of acquaintances. And there are a lot of people that we are friends with. That's the terminology that we use. That's because basically we're on speaking terms and we have shared some kind of conversation in times past. And, you know, we think about how many of you graduated from high school, you know, a few years ago. And virtually everyone in your class you were friends with, right? You know, I graduated back in 1976. That tells you how old I am, 62. And I was friends with everybody in my class and everybody in the class pretty much underneath me, and had a lot of friends in the class up above me because I always liked older girls, and so I had a lot of friends in the upper classrooms, you know. But many of them I haven't seen in 45 years or thereabout, you know, however long ago that's been, 44 years ago, I guess. But yet, I still consider them my friends. And a lot of them we have friended on Facebook. And so we watch each other's stuff, and sometimes we post, because even though we had not communicated together basically in 40 plus years, because of the relationship that we developed in that day, I still consider them to be a friend. And yet, at the same time, they don't necessarily fit in most of the categories that we talked about last week, because we don't associate together. A lot of times we don't live in close proximity. I don't have their numbers on speed dial in my telephone. They're not people that I've been around enough to know how well they're living, how much they trust God. So it wouldn't be like I would call them up and say, pray for me. You know, I got this going on or that going on. Because even though they are a friend, they're not the type of friend that that we talked about, the kind of real friend that what we really want or what we really need. Now, today's question, I'm going to reverse that. And I want to know this. I'm going to ask you today this question. How many people are you a friend to? Once we've learned what a real friend is, now can I ask you, are you a real friend to others? Or are you just an acquaintance to different people? The faux boys come every week, and I'm still trying to learn names. And I've got Dave down, amen? And Matt, and Cody, and Zachary. I got four down. I got Matt's over here. And I can't remember preacher, man. Now, I ain't gonna tell how many times he's been here. And yet I consider friend, and in a lot of ways, I'm closer even to this group of guys here and many of you in this room than what I am people that I've known my whole life. Because we have spent way more time together. We've sit in church together. We pray together. We talk together. We've eat meals together in fellowship. And so we have actually worked on our friendship. So I want to say that. Remember the scripture I gave you in Proverbs last week, 24:18, I believe it is. He who has friends must show himself friendly. That means that you've got, really, if I can ask you how many friends do you have, the better question is, how good a friend are you? Because that determines how many friends that you really do have, by how friendly that you are. How well are you accepted and believed and trusted by other people? How have you come across in your lifetime to the people that you associate with, even the family members sometimes? I know that a lot of times we may love our family, but we're not actually friends with people in our own family. In fact, a lot of times we're estranged, even though we still love them because they're brothers, sisters, uncles, aunts, whatever they may be. So the truth is, what we really need and want in life is to be a real friend. Now, Jesus, I use this term a lot because it's so true. He is our perfect example. He is the real friend. Amen. In fact, that's what he said. There is a friend that sticketh closer than a brother when you read the rest of that scripture in Proverbs, and that's him. So we are never alone in the fire or in the midst of the sea or in the prison, because we do have a real friend who does stick closer than a brother, because he's not now robed in flesh. He is back in spirit form, living in our hearts, and he goes with us wherever that we go. So we do have one real friend, but I'm sure that most of you in this room probably have more than one real friend. One of the worst things that ever happens to us in life as we grow up and mature is that when we are deceived by someone that we are friends with, whom we thought and had placed in our hearts in the category of being a real friend. Because when a real friend deceives you or does something contrary to what your wishes might be, it hurts deep. It hurts down to the core. And there are a lot of people, probably a lot of you in this room, who have been hurt by people that you thought were real friends. Can I have an amen? Now, so what that does to us is when somebody close to us hurts us that way, we begin to put a guard up so that we don't allow real friends to get in. And we need real friends. If there's one thing that the body of Christ is supposed to be, we're supposed to be real friends to the people that we associate with and to others. In fact, we're supposed to be the kind of person that other people would want to be our friend because we're real. Amen. And I like that word, and I want to use that for a little bit, because we need to be real. There doesn't need to be anything phony about us. There doesn't need to be anything that would label us hypocrite, because the word hypocrite that's used in the New Testament interprets to be putting on a show as an actor or an actress. And most of us have been in this community. We've been in churches. We've been around religious people who put on a show, who acted one way, said one thing, done certain things in front of other people to try and impress others, but when it really came down to it, they were not. They may have been friendly, but they were not the type of individual that you could classify as being your real friend. And when we're around that enough, it turns us off from people. And yet here we are, we need people. We need to be in that place where we have people that will agree with us, knowing what the Word of God says, where two or three agree as touching anything that shall be done of our Father. So we need at least two or three real friends, just so we got people to be in agreement with us, because we're all going to experience things in this world where we're going to need people to pray with us, people to encourage us, people to stand with you that have your back, that are not going to gossip, backbite, pray charismatic witchcraft prayers. They're going to want to pray with you, pray believing for you. They want to be there to encourage you. They're people that you can count on when the spiritual battles come. And not just those, but we're going to face things in life. Sometimes we're going to need people to take us to an airport or give us a place to stay overnight, whatever that it may be. We're all going to need real friends, and we need all of them that we can get. We don't need to be limiting ourselves. Now, in order for you and I to have a lot of real friends, that means that we're going to have to be the real friend. That means we're got to be the real deal. So my question to you today is, are you the real deal when it comes to being a friend? Are you the real deal? Are you deceiving people? Are you deceiving yourself? Do you have a wall built up that says, I'm not letting anybody in my inner circle? Because all of us have one, whether we're aware of it or not. We close ourselves off. We think that, you know what? I'm not going to get hurt again. I'm not going to allow that to happen to me again. True? Now, fellowship, now this is fellowship month. Let's look at fellowship again just for a minute. Fellowship is about activity when you get right down to it. When you begin to explore everything that's associated with fellowship, you're going to find that it's activities that promote friendship. It's anything that we can do that will make people feel better about the relationship that we have. You may be at work next week and there's something that somebody's got to do, and you weren't told to help them, and you may not even be inclined to help them, but something inside you as a Christian will tell you, you should just go ahead and help them. And I'll give you a little illustration. I was watching the other day. We had loaded a truck. I loaded the truck. I set 5 pallets on our little delivery truck, and it's sitting out front, and we had 3 guys that was sitting in chairs. We do that a lot this time of year. You can ask Brian. He knows all about that. So 3 guys are sitting in their chairs, and I load the truck. I'm on the forklift. That's the easy part. And I wonder who's going to be told. Everybody knows those 3 pallets have to be strapped down. Somebody's got to go out there and open the box and get the straps out and strap those pallets down, and then somebody else is going to have to deliver that load. Well, everybody's just sitting and waiting and watching, because everybody knows it's got to be done, but nobody really wants to do it. So, look, fortunately for me, I had to do something else on the forklift, so I'm still watching. So one of the guys gets up, and he goes out, starts strapping it down, and then another guy's like, oh gosh, I guess I better help him. So he gets up and he goes helps him. And then the both of them climb in the truck and they make the delivery together. Now that's the type of activity that promotes friendship. And it was a fellowship activity because they were working together. And then because they climbed in the truck together, they rode to the airport together, they undone it together, they talked together during the trip. See that the activity, the fellowship there promoted friendship. Now, if they were not friends before they left, then fellowship would not have been promoted. If they were at odds with each other, then one of the guys would sit there in the chair and said, I'm not helping him. He can do that by himself. It's too hot for me to go out there. Yeah. See, we're sometimes guilty of making excuses because a lot of times we're not the real friend that we need to be, okay? And we haven't realized what a difference that we can make. I shared something last week, and I'll share it again today. The truth is, people don't care what you think until they think you care. All right? You can write that down in your Bible and read that every week, because we're real quick to tell people what we think, but a lot of people are real quick just to turn a deaf ear. And if we're going to minister to people and sow good seed in people's life and love people and lead people to the Lord Jesus Christ, then people are going to have to think that we care about them. And before people are going to have to think that or think that we care about them, they're going to have to know that there's something different about us, and they're in order for them to open up and let us in. Now, here's something that I want you to remember. Fellowship happens when we keep the two greatest commandments. When those things are working in our life, everybody knows what they are, right? We're going to love the Lord our God with all our heart, all our soul, all our body, and all our strength. Love God first. And then the second one is likened to it. We will what? Love our neighbor as ourselves. Now, when we can begin to keep those two commandments, when we love God, you can't love your neighbor unless you love God. It ain't going to happen. When you begin to love God, then you begin to see people with God's eyes instead of your own eyes, and you look past everything that's wrong with people, because everybody has got something wrong with them. I look at you today, and you're all beautiful, and you look great, and I love you, and I'm glad that you're here. But I know that everybody's got something in their closet. Everybody's got something from their past. Everybody's going through something even as we speak. Everybody's got something on the table that you want God to deal with. And most everybody in this room doesn't want anybody else to know what's going on in their life, because we have not broken into their inner circle to that point where that we let people in. Because even though we're friends and we're really friendly, we may not be a real friend to each other yet. Now, the good news is that Word of Faith family, listen, we got more real friends here than we've ever had anywhere in our life. And I'm telling you, we got a great church. We may not be huge in numbers, but we are huge in relationship. Amen? And we got a lot of good friends. Now, we love God. Therefore, we have the ability to love our neighbors. We don't have to like our neighbors. I won't preach that sermon again. We may not like everything you do, everything they say, we may not like the way they drive around the block. You know, there's a lot of things we don't have to like about them, but we still got to love them. And when you love your neighbor, you'll be good to your neighbor. And when we're trying to keep the two greatest commandments, then we'll remember what Jesus said about the golden rule. So very simple. Do unto others as you would have them do unto you. Now, if we'll keep that in the back of our mind and place that in a place in our heart where when we begin to treat other people, associate with other people, and work with other people, whatever it may be, do unto others you would have them do unto you. If you want somebody to help you, then help others. If you want somebody to be kind to you, be kind to others. If you want people to love you, love others. If you want people to encourage you, then encourage others. Whatever a man sows, he reaps. As a real friend, we will sow real friendship into people's lives. We will do for them what they cannot many times do for themselves, or what's missing in their life, we're placing it there. That's what real friends do. When they feel unloved and you're a real friend, you will love them. You are replacing what's lost. And when people's been hurt and people's been lied on and talked too bad or whatever it may be, when you talk good and you're kind and you're loving, you are replacing what was lost. You are filling the gaps in other people's lives that they cannot fill for themselves. That's why that we need each other. It's why God placed us in one singular body, the body of Christ, so that we can be for other people what they is missing from their lives. We can be for you. I can be for you many things. Susan can be for you many things. We can be for each other many different things when those things are needed. We've just got to remember to follow those few simple rules. Love God, love our neighbor, do unto our neighbor as we would have them do unto you. I thought about the Beatitudes. I called them simple rules of fellowship. Amen. Simple rules. Matthew chapter 5, you can read all through there, you know, anytime you want. But remember some of them. One of them was be humble. Remember that? We preached on that for 6 weeks. That's what will be on the air today. Be humble. Be kind. Be merciful. Be a peacemaker when when it calls for it. Be patient. Be tolerant. Amen. Don't forget that one, because that's very important, to be patient and to be tolerant, because people are going to let you down. They're not going to be everything that you want them to be. But yet, those are simple things that God says that we can do, and it's about being that. All right? I can be merciful. I want people to have mercy on me. Amen. If I'm humble around other people, then they won't take on an air of arrogance and self-pride and all that crap. No kidding? Yeah. I can be kind, because if I'm kind, then other people will be kind. I'm not going to kick your dog unless it tries to bite me. I'm going to be kind, you know, and then I'm going to let you kick it. But anyway, be patient. Be tolerant. We have to be these things. And I share this today with really a kind of a double intent. It kind of worked out good. And I'll tell you why. Because we are living in a day and time where our world is full of racism and prejudice. It's everywhere, and it's growing stronger every day, everywhere. And as a believer in the body of Christ, as a Christian, we cannot go there. And I know how difficult it is, and I know how hard it is. And I know that if you don't fight it, you will not beat it. But we cannot go there. You will not find in God's word anywhere. In fact, he says the ground is level at the throne of grace. We all bleed red. It's not about the color of skin. God doesn't look on the outside of man. He looks on the inside. He didn't say to love your enemies unless they're a part of a gang or a group or something. There were no exceptions. We cannot be racist, and we cannot be prejudiced, and we cannot act racist, and we cannot act prejudice, and we cannot pray racist or pray prejudice, and we cannot speak it. We cannot go there. And I know that's hard, because I have to fight it myself. And when I say that, it's not just about color. It's about people's attitude. There's a lot of different ways that you can be prejudiced against a lot of things. I don't necessarily love Cubs fans, but that doesn't mean that I'm going to be a prejudice or racist against them, right? My son-in-law, he likes to give me a hard time about it. And Ron Worthington, we used to go round and round. And I got a new friend over at Sykeston, and his little boy had a Cubs shirt on. And I commented on his post, and we kind of go back and forth a little. We do it in fun. Amen. But you know what? There are a lot of people that don't do things in fun. We have to be careful. It is a battle that's got to be fought within, because of fellowship. See, that war is against fellowship. The world is at war. People are at war because of racism and prejudice right now. And it is destroying the world, not just the United States of America. And it is all part of a satanic plan to bring down America, because of the end times. And you've heard me say this. I know that some things have got to happen. And I never thought it would happen like it is, but it is. Amen. We're closer to the end than we've ever been. And if we don't fight against it, then we are egging it on. We cannot be a bystander on the side and think, well, it's not my battle. It's not my problem. If the church doesn't stand up, stand together, come together in fellowship through friendship, being real friends one to another, and stand against the evil that's out there, pray against the evil that's out there, love our neighbors as ourselves, then we're just contributing to a cause. And if I allow myself to be racist or prejudiced, then all I'm doing is falling into a religious trap as a Christian. And I want you to know, the spirit of a religion is probably the worst one that there is in all the world. We think spirits of addiction are bad and spirits of bondage and all those, but the spirit of religion is probably the worst one that there is. Amen. And we all have to fight it, because out of it comes racism and prejudice And if you don't believe me, just go back over and read the Gospels, because they hated Jesus. Who was it that hated him? The religious group of that day, the Pharisees, the scribes, the Sadducees, they hated him. They fought against him. They tried to stone him. They hated him with a passion and worked against him. And that same spirit is alive and more powerful today in our world than it was in Jesus' day. And is gaining strength because people will not fight against it. And they do it in the Spirit. In Luke chapter number 10, that's where I want to take the sermon from today, the message. Let me read you some scripture about the good Samaritan. Can I do that? Luke chapter 10, beginning with verse 30. And Jesus answering them said, "A certain man went down from Jerusalem to Jericho, and he fell among thieves, which stripped him of his raiment, and wounded him. And they departed, left him half dead by the side of the road. And by chance there came down a certain priest that way. And when the priest saw him, he passed by on the other side." He didn't even want to get close. "And not long after that, likewise a Levite, when he was at the place, he came and he looked on him. And then he passed by on the other side. And then a little while later, here comes a certain Samaritan as he journeyed. He came where the man was. And when he saw him, he had compassion on him. And he went to him and bound up his wounds. He poured in oil and wine, anointing him, and set him on his own beast and brought him to an inn and took care of him. And then on the morrow, the next day when he departed, he took out 2 pence and gave them to the host and said unto him, 'Take care of him. Whatsoever thou spendest more, when I come again, I will repay thee.' Which now of these three thinkest thou was neighbor unto him that fell among the thieves?" And he said, "He that showed mercy on him." Then said Jesus unto them, "Go and do likewise." Amen. Now I wanted to share this day. This is what the Lord laid on my heart, because first of all, I wanted you to see the spirit of religion at work in the priest and the Levite. Now, we're in church today. Amen. Why are we here? Because we serve God, right? Well, what was the priest and the Levite supposed to be doing? Serving God. But a spirit of religion, now hear this, it wars against fellowship. It doesn't try to bring it together. It tries to tear it apart. That's why that we have 1,500 denominations of churches in the world. That's why that every church has to have a sign that says First General Baptist or Second General Baptist or First Church of God. Amen. And they're on every street corner, and people think that's great. Well, it's only great because there's a place close to everybody where they can go to church. But the truth is, the church has been separating in units for years and years and years because they could not get along. Because they found something they didn't like. And instead of promoting fellowship, loving their neighbors or self, working together and becoming friends, real friends to each other, they separated and kept separating. They were selfish without compassion. When I ask you today, are you a real friend? What you got to do is check your capacities for compassion and just how selfish are we anyway. The only way that we'll know how good a friend that we might be to other people is by looking closely at ourselves. How much do I care about other people? How willing am I willing to help people who need my help? How willing am I to pray or to do whatever that I can to help somebody? Am I willing to give up my own time? Look what the Good Samaritan did. He came, he stopped. Now, the Samaritan represents the person that nobody liked. He was an outsider in that day. Most of the time, the Jews, the priests and the Levites would have traveled around Samaria because they didn't even want to associate with people that were Samaritans. The disciples couldn't believe that Jesus stopped at the well and spoke to a Samaritan woman. Remember that scripture? So we have the most unlikely candidate. And I use that term because I want you to realize that sometimes it's not the person you think is going to be your best friend who's going to be your best friend. Sometimes it's going to be the most unlikely candidate who's going to stand with you, who's going to pray with you, who's going to have your back, who's going to help you out when you least expected it. It may be somebody you just met yesterday who's going to be the best candidate that God ever placed within your life. Was it an accident that the Samaritan came by that day? No, because God knows the heart of men. And he knew the man that was laying and needing the help. And we live in a day and time where we miss opportunities. Get this today. We miss opportunities virtually every day of our life because we are walking around the problem areas because we don't want to be a party to that. We don't go anywhere in this world but what we meet people who need help, who are hurting, who have been stripped, who have been beat up by the world system. And people just ignore them. That's what the priest did. He saw it over there. He ignored it. He said, I'm not getting involved in that. Have we ever said that? I'm not getting involved in that one. The Levite comes along. He's a servant to the church. Think about it. He's supposed to be a servant to the church, the Levites. And he saw him and recognized he needed help, but yet, for whatever reason, he wouldn't take the time. He wasn't going to be involved in it either. No, it's not till this good Samaritan. That this story has went down now for in history 2,000 years. They're teaching it in Sunday school and sharing it with our kids. They're teaching our people, and we have to be taught sometimes how to be good to people. Isn't it a shame that we have to be taught how to be good to people? It doesn't say anything about the man. No doubt he looked rough. He'd been beaten up, left half dead. The good Samaritan does what? He takes care of. So where are the people who should have cared? Where are the people who should have cared? Where are we, the people, who should care? How often do we see, all right, with worldly eyes so that we pass by? That's what the priest and the Levite did. They looked at him with a physical eye. But when the Samaritan came, he saw him with his heart. With spiritual eyes. How often is it that we don't want to be involved? It's not my mess. It's not my problem. Too often, I'm afraid. The Samaritan saw him with a physical eye and saw him with a spiritual eye. He took care of him physically. Notice this. He took care of him physically. Friendship promotes fellowship. The guy didn't know him. He didn't know the guy. Names are never mentioned. But this man was a friend. What was it Jesus asked? Who was his neighbor? What are we supposed to do with our neighbors? Love our neighbor as ourselves. The Samaritan saw him with the heart of God and said, if that were me laying there and I was in that shape, I would want somebody to help me. I would want somebody to bind up my wounds. I would want somebody to feed me. I would want somebody to take me someplace and not leave me on the side of this road. I would want somebody to stand with me and protect me or help me in the future. And the Samaritan saw him with Christian eyes and thought, I'm going to do all that I can. And he did. And you know what he did in the process? He made a friend for life. The Samaritan made a friend for life because fellowship is what? It's activities that promotes friendship. And so the Samaritan promoted friendship. He became a real friend whether that guy wanted it or not. He thought, I'm going to be the right person. I'm going to do the right thing. And I'm going to help this man. And I promise you that man appreciated it. And that man appreciated it the rest of his life. And that man told others, you won't believe what that fella did for me. You won't believe how he took care of me, how he anointed me, how he took me to the inn, how he paid my fare till I could get well. You will not believe how good that person is. Because that man was a real friend to somebody who didn't have a friend. And out here in our world, there's lots of people who don't have a friend. They do not have a real friend. And everybody in this room probably has learned that. They're a real friend till the money runs out. They're a real friend till you ask them to do something for you. They're a real friend until you really need them, and then they ain't got time for you. And then you're left holding your hands up thinking, What am I going to do? I need somebody. I need some help. I need someone. They need us. They need me, and they need you because they need a real friend. They need someone who will put on the Good Samaritan shoes. Someone who will say, I'll do it. I'll be there. Because a real friend shows compassion, a real friend supplies needs, and a real friend offers encouragement. Remember? Exactly what this man did. I thank God I got a lot of real friends. I got some right here. I know that. I got people I can count on. And then I think, well, hopefully, Lord willing, it's because they know that I'm a real friend to them. That I'm there for them. I'll do what I can for you. I don't just say that. I try that. Sometimes I'm at loss at what I can do. You know what Jesus said about making friends? He said in Luke 16, verse 9, he said that we are to make friends from the unrighteous mammon. And I say unto you, make to yourself friends of the mammon of unrighteousness, that when you fall, they may receive you into everlasting habitation. It's hard for me to see. And I used to look at that scripture, and I read it in four different translations. And you know what it really means? To make friends from people that you wouldn't think would be friendly. Not from the people, we look around and think, hey, I'd like to have them as my friend. Next time you see somebody that you don't want to be friends with, that's the one God's pointing you to right there. How are we going to get people saved and right with God if we're not a real friend to them? How are they going to believe our report and what we have to say about Jesus and our testimony of what God has done for us unless we break through into their inner circle? It's not going to happen. And Jesus was telling you, hey, you know what? When you make a real friend, even if they're a part of the world, when you need them, they'll still be there. I know people right now who don't go to church and they may or may not be saved, but if I had to call on them, they'd help me out. And many of you do too. Only because you have been a real friend to them and you have done something for them and helped them. There has been an activity, a fellowship activity in your life that they've never forgotten. Leanne, come back to Word of Faith Family. How come? From when? 17 years ago? Yeah. You know what we did 17 years ago? We made a friend that didn't forget. You know what we're doing with a lot of you? We're making friends with you. You'll never forget. You may move on. You may go away. No telling. Some of you we may never see again. When they leave, they'll know that we care. I thought about Genesis chapter 4, verse 10. This is amazing. When Cain killed his brother Abel, God said this, "The voice of thy brother's blood crieth unto me from the ground." When Cain killed his brother, they were out of fellowship. They weren't even friends. And the blood of his brother's voice. You hear that? The voice of thy brother's blood crieth unto me from the ground. Who wants to stand before God and the voice of a brother's blood is crying up from the ground? Have you thought about it? Ezekiel said, blood on our hands because we didn't do the work that was before us. We live in a day and time where if church doesn't get real active and stand strong and be supportive of each other and then reach out into our world with love and compassion and meet the needs of people and encourage people that are lost, the voice of people in our community and around our world be crying from the ground. It's a sad thing to think about. You know how hard it is anymore to get souls saved? Get people come to church? They know they need God. They know they do. They know they need to be in church. And yet they've been so turned off by it that it's so hard to get them there. Why do people get turned off from church? Because of religion, broken fellowship, with no friendship. It's simple as that. We war against it all the time. In 1 John, there's a couple scriptures I want to read you before we get done today. 1 John chapter 2, verse 9 and 10, the Bible says this, "He that saith he is in the light and hateth his brother is in darkness even unto now. But he that loveth his brother abideth in the light, and there is none occasion of stumbling in him." Do we love our brother? Didn't Jesus say that we are our brother's keeper? And that we are to take care and bear one another's burdens, especially our own brethren. And if we say that we are and we're not, then what did he say? We're in darkness, even until now. And then 1 John 1, 6 and 7, it says, "If we say that we have fellowship with him and walk in darkness, we lie and do not the truth. But if we walk in the light as he is in the light, we have fellowship one with another, and the blood of Jesus Christ, his son, cleanses us from all sin." Amen. See, fellowship is very important. I guess it's why that we have fellowship month this month. I questioned that when they told me that. Do you know what? It's time for the church to be in fellowship. It's time that we love one another, encourage one another, pray for one another, stand with one another. It's time that we devote time and real effort to being a real friend to people who needs us. A real friend. Willing to do whatever is necessary to help that one. Amen? For God to use us, to be a blessing. We want to be in fellowship with Father, right? To be in fellowship with Father, we got to be in fellowship one with another. As simple as that. Now, let me ask you that question again. We're going to close. Are you a real friend to others? Are you a real friend? It's not about how many real friends that you may have, but that's important. The most important thing is that you're a real friend to others. Are you the one they can count on? Are you the one they'll come to? Are you the one they're going to ask to pray for? Are you that one? Let's stand together. Can we do that? All right, now let's be blessed. Listen up, children. As you approach each day your battles, don't let your hearts faint. Fear not, do not tremble, neither be afraid. For the Lord our God is he that goes with us to fight for us against all of our enemies to keep us safe. And now the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord makes his face to shine upon you and is gracious to you. The Lord lifts up his countenance upon you and gives you his awesome and wonderful peace. Amen.